variants detected in Liverpool and Bristol in the UK. U.S. President Joe Biden stressing the need for a free and open Indo-Pacific region in its first conversation with its Chinese counterpart since assuming the presidency. And the Philippines Commission on Population and Development urging local governments to improve their reproductive health drive amid alarming cases of young pregnancies. POPCOM Executive Director Undersecretary Juan Antonio Perez III will join us later on for a discussion on that. Good afternoon. I'm Carmina Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us today. And for those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, nice to have you with us as well. Let's begin. Quezon City set to conduct contact tracing and testing in a village where a man tested positive for the UK coronavirus variant. The 35-year-old patient was quarantined in an apartment with another individual in Riverside Commonwealth. He was an overseas Filipino worker from Korea. He returned last August and made frequent trips to an employment agency in Malate, Manila. The Quezon City Epidemiology and Surveillance Unit says the patient's condition will be strictly monitored. Mayor Joy Belmonte is also appealing to the Bureau of Quarantine to determine whether or not the patient's employment agency is liable for not following health protocols. Cebu City will not tighten quarantine measures just yet, despite a rise in coronavirus cases. Mayor Edgardo Labella says the numbers have gone up due to the local government's mass testing and contact tracing efforts. But he assures the public hospitals in the city still have enough beds and isolation centers. That's after the Octa Research Group warned the city's hospital bed capacity may reach critical level due to the spike in infections since January.
Maski in GC kami, marami rin kaming restrictions pa. I think it's good for business na hindi lang muna natin galawin. Anyway, we are confident na with this undertaking that we have, itong massive contact tracing natin that eventually bababa rin ito.
Cebu City is currently under modified general community quarantine. The general manager of the Metrorail Transit Line 3, or MRT3, has passed away days after contracting COVID-19. The Transportation Department confirmed the death of Rodolfo Garcia. He was 77 years old. Garcia was in critical condition last week after testing positive for COVID-19. Last month, a coronavirus outbreak hit the MRT3's Quezon City Depot, with 42 personnel contracting the virus. One other MRT employee has died from the disease. On Wednesday, the Philippine Health Department announced 114 additional COVID-19 deaths, the most since January 15. Two new COVID-19 variants have been identified in England. One of the new variants was first detected in Bristol and has been classified as a concern. The other was discovered in Liverpool. Both of them have mutations similar to the ones seen in the South African and Brazilian variants of COVID-19. But England's health officials assure the public current vaccines are effective against them. Two face masks are better than one. That's according to new research by the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. The CDC says tightly fitted surgical masks or a cloth mask atop the surgical mask will provide better protection against the coronavirus. The CDC found that the double mask combination blocked 92.5% of cough particles. It also discovered that the transmission of the virus can be reduced by up to 96.5%. This new guidance comes as the UK COVID-19 variant continues to spread across the US.
Based on this new information, the CDC is updating the mask information for the public on the CDC website to provide new options on how to improve mask fit. This includes wearing a mask with a moldable nose wire, knotting the ear loops on your mask, or wearing a cloth mask over a procedure or disposable mask. There are also new options available to consumers called mask fitters, small reusable devices that cinch a cloth or medical mask and that can create a tighter fit against the face and thus improve mask performance. The bottom line is this: masks work, and they work best when they have a good fit and are worn correctly.
In other news, the ATIS charged under the anti-terrorism law say they will drop the National Union of People's Lawyers as their legal counsel. Speaking in an online press briefing organized by the country's anti-communist insurgency task force on Wednesday, Jaapir Gurung and Junior Ramos criticized the NUPL for exacerbating the situation and for allegedly forcing them to cooperate investigations. They were referring to their failed bid to intervene in the petitions challenging the Anti-Terrorism Act before the Supreme Court. The two had filed a petition through their lawyers at NUPL, alleging direct injury at the hands of law enforcers. But the NUPL asserts they neither forced nor bribed their clients to file the petition. It adds Gurung and Ramos may have been influenced to change counsel.
Simple lang ang salita ni Junior, nalilito na po kami, ang dami nang lumalapit. Wala sila sa posisyon para magsalita at mamili ng kanilang kung anong makakaganda sa kanila. Maliwanag, pasasikat ng araw na sila ay nakakulong, kontrolado sila sa loob, at wala silang kontrol sa sarili nilang kalayaan. So, kapit sa patalim yung mga kapatid nating minorya para sabihin nila o tumanggi na, hindi, sa NUPL pa rin kami. May mga abogado nagpupunta doon at nagpapakilalang abogado, samantalang kami yung counsel on record. Dapat magpasintabi sila kung sino ang counsel on record bago nila puntahan yung mga akusado. Although, siyempre, clandestine na pagkilos yan para mawala sa NUPL ang representasyon ng mga katutubong minorya na inuli at inaresto o kinasuhan doon sa paglabag sa anti-terrorism. Wala kaming galit na binigay.
Philippine Transportation Secretary Arthur Tugade appeals to private motor vehicle inspection centers to lower their prices and suspend re-inspection fees for 1 year. Tugade says PMVICs should align their rates with those of private emission testing centers, which charge up to 800 pesos per inspection. PMVICs collect 1,800 pesos for each vehicle inspection and 900 pesos for re-inspections. This comes after some senators called for the suspension of PMVICs, arguing their operations are not based on any law. Filipinos in Myanmar may be evacuated to nearby Thailand. That's if tensions following the military takeover intensify. Philippine Ambassador to Myanmar Eduardo Capunan Jr. says he is already coordinating with the Thai embassy so Filipinos can seek temporary shelter there.
Sa katunayan po, ako ay binigyan po ng authority ng ating Secretary of Foreign Affairs to do drastic measures kung sakali mang gumulo. Like for example, I can close down the embassy.
Okay.
You know, I can evacuate all Filipinos by air, by sea, whatever. So yun po ang minamonitor namin na para magkawa po kaming kaukulang pamamaraan.
Capunan adds more Philippine representatives have been deployed in Myanmar to ensure Filipinos keep in touch with authorities amid a ban on social media platforms. Currently, there are over 1,200 Filipinos in Myanmar. Malacañang organizing a food security summit to address the country's supply problems, such as meat shortages and high vegetable prices. April Rafales tells us more.
Alam natin na may kahirapan.
Malacañang is calling for a food security summit, hoping to address issues affecting the agriculture sector, such as the rise in pork prices, the continuing threat of the African swine fever, and the drop in farm gate prices of unhusked rice. The palace says the summit aims to develop a national food security plan, but no date has been set yet. Meanwhile, many consumers in Metro Manila are relieved to see more stalls in wet markets selling pork again after a so-called pork holiday. Some of them admit feeling sorry for the vendors.
Siyempre, kailangan din nilang kumita. Wala naman po silang magagawa kung yun pong mahal ang pagkakakuha nila sa baboy, mahal din pagkakabenta.
The pigs from General Santos City that the Department of Agriculture promised have started to arrive early Wednesday morning. But the vendors in a Quezon City wet market complained the supply is not enough.
8 piraso, ma'am. Dapat sana mas marami sana sa 8. Mga 15 piraso po. Baka ngayon meron, baka bukas wala. Kaya po sana naman, sana araw-araw magbigay yung Department of Agriculture.
The Agriculture Department says more pork will arrive in the coming days, as Mindanao committed to send 10,000 hogs per week to the National Capital Region, which has a demand of 4,000 hogs daily.
In Mindanao, they have committed 10,000 a week. Surplus production niya. Yung pong the South Cotabato is OSPA is producing hogs excess for Metro Manila Luzon markets. Madadagdagan yan pati ng imported meat.
The Department of Trade and Industry will soon impose a suggested retail price for imported frozen pork and require vendors to label their products properly so consumers can distinguish them from newly slaughtered local pork.
Kung imported ito at mas mura na ipasok dito, ay siguradong dapat ang presyo rin nila mas mababa. Pinag-uusapan din ngayon sa Tariff Commission yung pag-consider muna magbaba muna sandali ng taripa para mas mapamura pa yung imported at makahabol yung supply sa demand.
Vendors of imported meat meanwhile can commit to abiding by the suggested retail price set by the government.
Pag binigay po ng supplier ng mababa, mababa rin pong isusundin po namin yung binigay na presyo. Pero kung hindi po kaya, hindi po kami pwedeng magtinda ng suggested retail price ng ating gobyerno. Meron magiging resulta noon, baka pahinga muna. O kaya mag-fresh meat kami kung anong magandang
April Rafales, ABS-CBN News.
The Commission on Population and Development recently came out with a grim picture of what is happening on the ground. Girls as young as 10 years old giving birth, putting the lives of both baby and mom at risk. According to the Commission, although there was a decline in babies being born to mothers aged 10 to 19 in the National Capital Region, the fact remains these young girls are not supposed to be in that situation to begin with and that there must be an intervention. Joining us now, Undersecretary Juan Antonio Perez III. He's Executive Director of POPCOM. Undersecretary Perez, welcome to the program. Thank you for joining us today.
Yes, I'm happy to be with you, Carmina. Good noon to everyone.
All right, very important topic we're about to talk about today. First of all, I want to know, how did we get here? What led us to this situation, Undersecretary?
Well, there has been a big jump in the number of young people engaging in premarital sex, which happened around 2013 when the UP Population Institute conducted the Young Adult Fertility Survey. They noted that up to one-third of girls and boys 15 to 19 years old were already engaging in premarital sex. Mm. At the same time, they noted an increase in access to social media, the internet, 85% having cell phones. Also, this was a time when around the time when the Supreme Court came out with a ruling that was saying that basically young people, even who are minors, even if they are mothers themselves or have children already or are currently pregnant, cannot access family planning services unless they have the consent of their parents, which was the reverse of the situation before 2013. So all of these confluence of events, came together, and we're seeing the result of increasing teen pregnancies, particularly among minors. Mm. And there were things also in the RH law that were supposed to happen early on, like comprehensive sexuality education. But today, 8 years after the law came into effect, it's only being implemented so far in 3 regions, which started last October. Mm. So things have come together to give this result in that way.
Because of course, Undersecretary, if you are a young person and you're sexually active, the last person you'd want to talk to about it, in some families, would be your parents. That's the reality, right, for some children. As you said, this Supreme Court ruling sort of added to the problem. They would keep it from their parents instead of, you know, actively seeking advice from a third party as to what they can do to better protect themselves, Undersecretary.
Yes, actually, what the Supreme Court said is it's not the role of government to provide these services at this time. The Constitution is saying that it's a primary role of parents to do so. But survey after survey have shown that parents are reluctant to talk about sex and sexuality with their children. And you also have educational institutions, teachers, who are also reluctant to talk about it. So absent these two key institutions, you have teenagers dealing with these situations themselves, talking to each other. You know, they have the same level of knowledge about sexuality and with the institutions not able to provide this input, you have this increase in activity, sexual activity, behavior that is risky for teenagers. No? Hmm. So we really have to catch up with the situation.
Right, but there's been a decline, though, in numbers. But that doesn't mean, as we've been discussing, that it has been eradicated. But what do you think? What led to the decline in the numbers, Undersecretary?
Yeah, the decline has been seen in the 15 to 19 year age group. It's gone from 200,000 in 2014. Hmm. Na teenage pregnancies, and it's now around 180,000. But that's really a very small dent.
Correct.
On the very big figure. We still have 500 adolescents giving birth. But if you drill down to, no, from 10 to 19 years old, if you look at the minors, the 18 years old and below, that has been steady at around 62,000. Girls giving birth every year. And if you drill down even lower to the 10 to 14 age group, we noted that for the last 9 years, year on year, there is an increase in the number of 10 to 14 year old girls giving birth. So that is where there is an increase in fertility that is driving the increase in minors giving birth. And so we have been proposing that we set up a social protection program for minors who are giving birth. And that would cover the 62,000 minors giving birth plus, of course, there's 60,000 plus children. So that's that group needs social protection, but also we need to ramp up our support for education, health, social welfare interventions, also community level interventions for the very young adolescents. So
because
that's something we're having to put together now.
Yeah, because Undersecretary, with the way things are going, it's well on its way to becoming a reality, because this has an intergenerational factor to it. And we don't want that to happen. Because if that's become your reality already, that you were born to a mother at such a young age, then you would think that, yeah, maybe that's the norm. And you also would have that kind of a reality as well. And that's what you're going up against.
Yes, there was a study made by the UP, by Professor Perrin and of UP and the UNFPA, which showed that the impact of early motherhood, you might say, is costing these young mothers 33 billion pesos a year that they lose because many of them do not complete school.
Right.
They have to take on lower paying jobs. And quite a number of them repeat the pregnancy. You know, they have a second, third, fourth child. Mm-hmm. And there was a study that NRCP came up with just this week, which says that if you're a mother who's had a baby and then you have a second baby as a minor, you never complete school. And you're really relegated to a life of poverty that you cannot get away from.
Yeah. And that's why the intervention is key. But I want to take a moment now, Undersecretary, to take a closer look at some of the LGUs and how they're faring. According to your report, among local government units, Quezon City was recorded to have the most number of births to mothers aged 10 to 19 in 2019. I think it's a little over 4,000. And then that's followed by Manila with almost 4,000, Caloocan City about 2,500, and San Juan City with 100, Pateros 95. What is the story behind these numbers that is sort of exclusive to these LGUs, or do these LGUs basically have the same story here that they're not able to implement fully the reproductive health care law?
Yeah, of course, the local governments take the lead from what national government is able to provide in terms of technical assistance. And if you look at it really, Carmina, the three regions, NCR, Calabarzon, and Central Luzon, 23,000 minors gave birth in those regions, three regions in 2019. That's one out of every three minors giving birth happening in these three regions. It's a matter of larger populations in these three areas. But it's also a fact that we have not been able to really set up the preventative measures everywhere nationwide. Mm-hmm. What we've seen also is even outside Metro Manila, you also have pockets of increasing teen pregnancy in northern Mindanao, Cagayan de Oro area, and in Cebu and Davao. Those are areas where we're seeing more of these pregnancies happening. It's also a factor that the Department of Health requires teenagers to give birth in hospitals. Mm. So much so that these young girls have to come to the cities to give birth. Mm. And that, you know, increases the number of births that we're seeing in these cities.
It's in terms of recording as well. But let me ask you this, Undersecretary. Are you at this point already where you would categorize what we've been talking about as a national social emergency?
Yes, actually, our board of commissioners in the Commission on Population and Development already drafted an executive order for the president to declare it a national social emergency. It was passed on to the Malacanang last year. Mm. And they asked us again when Secretary Chua came on, does Secretary Chua support this? And we wrote back, and yes, we think it's still important. So we are pushing for a formal declaration by Malacanang, but the board of PAPCON already agreed that it is indeed a national social emergency. And we hope that Congress at some point will take cognizance of this and also come up with the institutional policies, making it really a policy of government to provide social protection for teenage mothers and to come up with a preventive measures in terms of broader comprehensive sexuality education that's not only school-based. We have to go to the community, reach out to the parents.
Yes.
So we need, in a way, a tweaking of the current services for young people. Mm. Also to allow access. If you declare it an emergency, young people should then have easier access to family planning and reproductive health services. If they are pregnant, they have children, or in a way are sexually active already because they've had a miscarriage or such. So those are things that we hope to put in place within the year. But definitely, we will start providing services for adolescents in some key cities. We're working together with some mayors to start the institutional reforms, you might say, to make it easier for young people to get services.
And thereby
reduce pregnancy.
Yeah, here's the thing, though, Undersecretary. Mm-hmm. People watching us now may just think, so what? These kids, they're getting sexually active. That's all there is to it. But what they fail to comprehend is that this is talking about the future of this nation. This is talking about poverty. This is talking about all these girls not getting empowered enough so that they can also fend for themselves and be empowered as they grow up to be young ladies. They may not even have that chance because of the situation that we're in right now. That's what we're talking about here, Undersecretary.
Yeah, if you look at it, with 60,000 minors giving birth every year, in the past 5 years, we've had 300,000 families started by minor children. And that impacts on poverty in this country. Because we believe it is in these families where you have the most difficult problem when it comes to poverty. It will be their families that will be the last to be in line to, you know, to have a better life. Mm. And what we want to do is, by setting up a social protection program earlier, we can take them out of the equation.
No?
Right now, in a way, they are an unnecessary contribution to increasing poverty in the country. And we could do something about it.
Mm. Here's the thing.
That's why we're pushing this.
Here's another thing that we have yet to talk about, Undersecretary. Everything that we talked about so far since our conversation began was pre-pandemic, right? Yeah. The numbers that we talked about, pre-COVID. Mm-hmm. But now there's this pandemic and the lockdowns. So I want to ask you, how is this pandemic and all these lockdowns complicating matters even further?
Well, we anticipated, and there is some evidence that it's more difficult to get family planning, reproductive health services in areas where you have lockdowns. I think particularly Metro Manila has been heavily affected in terms of our program. But in other areas of the country, it's easier to get services. But some couples are saying, I can't get to the health center because hindi ako pinapayagan mag-back ride sa motor.
Mm.
You know, because so how do they get to the centers to get services if it's some distance? So difficulty in access during pandemics is happening, but only in those areas where you have GCQ or lockdowns. And in other areas, there's more access. But you can imagine NCR, the surrounding regions, probably some cities, are where they're having more difficulty. And because of that, we're expecting if there's a failure of the program, maybe 1 to 2 million women not being able to access family planning, that could lead to 200,000 to 700,000 additional unplanned pregnancies. And 10% of that will be among teenagers or young people.
All right. So the conversation has to continue. And we're going to be speaking to lawmakers as the days go by about their plans as well when we talk about the interventions that are needed at this point to be able to address this national social emergency, as you have called it. Undersecretary Juan Antonio Perez III, Executive Director of POPCOM, we appreciate you joining us this morning. You take care and you keep safe.
Thank you, Carmina, and you do that too.
Thank you.
Good afternoon.
Take care. We're going to take a quick break now. When we return, U.S. President Joe Biden speaks to his Chinese counterpart, Xi Jinping, for the first time since taking office. And also later, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers celebrate their Super Bowl win with a socially distanced victory parade. Stay tuned. This is Dateline Philippines, Yarn ANC.
hango ng Sakura Blossom. Nasa Pride with fabric conditioner na. May Sakura Blooming Curls para sa labas.
Have to be a working manager and a leader at the same time. Your team will only do as you do and not as you say, so it's very important to set the right example.
People who are in the leadership sector should be able to walk the talk. You cannot preach about sustainability without making sacrifices, small sacrifices in your lifestyle. That's the key. It will redound to the individual behavior of the people preaching and of the people actually following.
Authentic community, by focusing on that particular core value, a lot of these Gen Zs and millennials can be themselves. They don't have to pretend anymore. As we prioritize the voices and the feedback of our young,
And we're back. You're still with Dateline Philippines. Here's another look at our headlines today. Quezon City on alert for the possible spread of the UK COVID-19 variant after one case slipped past quarantine protocols. Two new coronavirus variants detected in Liverpool and Bristol in the UK. U.S. President Joe Biden stressing the need for a free and open Indo-Pacific region in his first conversation with his Chinese counterpart since assuming the presidency. And the Philippines' Commission on Population and Development urges President Duterte to declare a national social emergency amid alarming cases of young pregnancies. It also calls on local governments to improve their reproductive health drive. Back with more news, the World Health Organization approves the use of AstraZeneca's COVID-19 vaccine on individuals over 65 years old. The agency, however, reminded vaccine recipients to make sure that they get their second shot within 8 to 12 weeks to ensure its efficacy. In its interim recommendations, the WHO panel also said there is no reason not to recommend AstraZeneca's vaccine despite a reduced efficacy against the South African variant of the coronavirus. Earlier this week, South Africa paused its rollout of AstraZeneca's vaccine after data showed that it appears less effective against mild to moderate cases from COVID variant discovered in the country, or from the variant discovered in the country. But the WHO said anything that will reduce the risk of infection is justified. President Duterte has just ordered the deferment of the implementation of the child car seat law. That announcement was made by palace spokesperson Harry Roque just a few minutes ago. The child car seat law, which mandates the use of car seats for children up to the age of 12, has been criticized by several sectors, calling it an added expense during the pandemic. Roque also announced private motor vehicle inspection centers are no longer necessary. Some senators called for the suspension of the PMVICs, arguing their operations are not based on any law. World news, the Pentagon will review its strategy towards China, including Washington's military footprint in that part of the world. That's according to U.S. President Joe Biden, who visited the Pentagon for the first time since his inauguration. Biden said he was briefed on a new China task force that would look at the U.S. military strategy in relation to China. The 15-member task force is expected to present recommendations within 4 months.
We need to meet the growing challenges posed by China to keep peace and defend our interests in the Indo-Pacific and globally. Today, I was briefed on a new DOD-wide China task force that Secretary Austin is standing up to look at our strategy and operational concepts, technology and force posture, and so much more. The task force will work quickly, drawing on civilian and military experts across the department to provide, within the next few months, recommendations to Senator Austin on key priorities and decision points so that we can chart a strong path forward on China-related matters. It will require a whole-of-government effort, bipartisan cooperation in Congress, and strong alliances and partnerships. That's how we'll meet the China challenge and ensure the American people win the competition of the future.
On Wednesday, Biden also spoke to his Chinese counterpart, his first direct contact with Xi Jinping since assuming power. Biden told Xi it was a U.S. priority to preserve a free and open Indo-Pacific region. The U.S. has contested China's extensive territorial claims, accusing Beijing of militarizing the South China Sea and intimidating its neighbors like the Philippines. The Biden administration touching base with its allies to help Beijing or to help keep Beijing in check. Philippine Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana says he spoke on the phone with his U.S. counterpart Lloyd Austin to discuss bilateral security issues, including China's aggression in the South China Sea. Both officials underscored the importance of upholding international rules and norms in the contested waters. That includes a 2016 arbitral ruling that invalidated China's sweeping claims over the waterway. Lorenzana is also convinced strong ties between Manila and Washington will remain despite America's change of leadership.
The do we have to strengthen our relations with our allies? I think there is no need to do that because it has always been strong. And our friends in the region, like Japan, Korea, New Zealand, Australia, and the ASEAN countries are all in support of a peaceful and stable Indo-Pacific region. We also have to nurture our relationship with China. China is a very close neighbor, and we have a lot of engagement with them, especially trade. And we cannot choose between the two.
Yes.
I said let us we should not be made to choose between supporting the US or supporting China. I think we should balance our relationships with them.
The defense chief also revealed that Manila and Washington officials will meet this month to iron out differences on the visiting forces agreement. President Rodrigo Duterte suspended the VFA for a second time in November. And while the Philippine military wants to keep the pact in place, Lorenzana said the final decision on the matter still rests with the president. An international studies professor believes China will not hesitate to use its new Coast Guard law against the Philippines. That's despite the Duterte administration's attempts to forge closer ties with Beijing. The law allows the Chinese Coast Guard to use lethal force on foreign vessels that Beijing sees as illegally entering its waters. Apart from the danger this poses to the lives of Filipino fishermen, Renato De Castro from the De La Salle University says, the law will also affect the Philippines' food security.
Our poor, marginalized fisher folks, with their wooden outriggers, being confronted by Chinese Coast Guard, still Chinese Coast Guard vessels sailing all the way from Hainan Island, just to prevent our ordinary fishing folks from earning their living. And of course, their catch basically sustained the country. So this is something very basic to every Filipino. What we are served on our table, fish and rice.
The historic impeachment trial against former U.S. President Donald Trump gathers steam, with Democrats laying out their evidence against the Republican leader. Lawmakers showed fresh footage of last month's deadly siege at the Capitol, saying Trump did little to stop the violence. They add Trump planted the seeds for the riot by making false claims that the recent presidential election was rigged.
You've seen all the evidence so far. And this is clear. On January 6th, President Trump left everyone in this Capitol for dead. When he wanted to incite his supporters to show up on January 6th, President Trump tweeted 16 times between midnight on January 5th and his noon rally speech the next day. 16 times to get them to do something he wanted. And his message in those 16 times was clear. Fight. Stay strong. Be strong. But when the violence started, he never once said the one thing everyone around him was begging him to say. Stop the attack. He refused to stop it.
The House of Representatives has charged Trump with inciting insurrection, but Trump's lawyers argue his rhetoric is protected by the constitutional right to free speech. They also allege the trial is politically motivated. The U.S. Senate could conclude its debates as early as this coming weekend. The World Economic Forum has no plans to further delay Singapore's Davos meeting if the August date doesn't push through. Organizers hope attendees will be able to avoid quarantines through rigorous testing and by staying in a bubble cut off from the local population. The WEF's preferred venue for the summit is the Marina Bay Sands.
We think there are
reasonable to plan for a meeting the 17th to 20th of August. We can scale it up or we can scale it down. I think it's more a question of how big of a meeting can we have in August. The COVID situation is extremely well managed in Singapore. And the government also said to us they would be happy to host a special meeting for the World Economic Forum here. And we also thought it was nice to have a chance to physically meet again after we had digital Davos in January.
The WEF has pushed back its special meeting in Singapore twice after the COVID-19 outbreak in Europe forced the organization to move the event from its usual home in the Swiss Alps. It will, however, return to Davos in January 2022. The Asian Development Bank sees regional trade declining as the COVID-19 pandemic disrupts global supply chain. Let's hear more from Warren de Guzman.
The Asian Development Bank says COVID-19 has pushed certain countries to reshore parts of the global supply chain to improve their own resilience. In other words, some manufacturing operations are moving back to their home country or region. Sin-Yung Park of the ADB estimates the reshoring of just 10% of the supply chain could cause a 13% reduction in regional trade, while the reshoring of 20% would cause a 22% decline in trade. The ADB ran a simulation to see which countries would be affected the most.
According to the simulation results, the countries that rely more heavily on the global regional value chain are going to be more affected. That means countries in Southeast Asia, also countries in Central Asia, because they have a high integration with the European value chain. So Malaysia, Singapore, like Korea, you know, Brunei, Darussalam, Kazakhstan, Australia, since Australia is also part of a stronger the regional value chain in Asia Pacific.
Park, however, says the Philippines can benefit from the other trends COVID-19 has sparked, such as the rapid digitalization of global trade.
I do believe that the Philippines has a strong potential, given that the post-pandemic trade landscape will give a more weight on the digital and services trade. And in all respect, actually, the Philippines has a comparative advantage in the services sector. And then they are really you know, service oriented. And then in terms of even you know, export of a lot of service personnel, you know, and even when they are not exporting, there's also offshore call center. They can provide the services from the Philippines to the world.
There's just one problem. Connectivity. A joint study by the ADB and Thinking Machines shows the poorest cities in the Philippines have to deal with fixed broadband and mobile download speeds of between 4 and 7 megabytes per second, while the richest cities enjoy speeds of over 25 Mbps. But even in the National Capital Region, people like 19-year-old student Mark Angelo Dio can't get access to consistently stable high-speed internet services.
Na-experience ko po yung sobrang lag and hindi po ako makapasok sa school. Siguro po, hindi pa po kasi develop yung ano eh, yung internet dito sa Pilipinas. Eh. Like in sa ibang bansa po, mas angat sila kasi yung technology po nila is mas advanced kasi sa atin.
Seaman Jorik Batung, meanwhile, is thankful he doesn't have to go online anymore for training. With his experience of telecom services abroad, he believes the Philippines needs to open up the sector.
Pag sa survey, talagang bagal po ng internet kasi natin talaga, di ba? So, try nilang papasukan yung ibang internet provider siguro kasi parang sinasakal.
Philippine Telecoms say they are doing their best to upgrade their systems. Globe Telecoms announced it had installed 39 new cell towers in underserved areas in Mindanao, North and South Luzon, and Visayas to improve the call, SMS, and data experience of customers. It has a capex plan of up to 90 billion pesos for the year. PLDT Smart announced a capex plan of between 88 and 92 billion pesos to improve telco services in 2021. Meanwhile, the next major telco player, Dito Telecommunications, led by Davao-based businessman Dennis Oi and backed by Chinatel, is expected to launch commercially next month. The ADB says business process outsourcing and overseas Filipino workers can help the Philippines recover from the COVID-19 pandemic. But there are still many Filipinos in-country on the wrong side of the digital divide who could get left behind. Warren De Guzman, ABS-CBN News.
Despite rising inflation, the Philippine Central Bank is expected to keep interest rates steady this afternoon during its first policy meeting of the year. Economists polled by Reuters predict the central bank will leave the rate on its overnight reverse repurchase facility unchanged at a record low of 2% to support the country's pandemic-hit economy. But if economic indicators don't show an improvement and government spending remains lackluster in the first quarter, Kanika Bhatnagar of ANZ believes the central bank could issue another rate cut of 25 basis points at its March meeting. In the meantime, Joey Rojas of Eagle Equity says the BSP can convince banks to lend more.
This type of inflation, you cannot cure by lowering, by raising interest rates. This is a cost-push inflation.
Mm-hmm.
So by raising interest rates, you will increase costs further. There's really nothing more. Maybe moral suasion?
In sports, the Philippine Games and Amusements Board, or GAB, files an appeal with the World Boxing Association, or WBA, to restore Manny Pacquiao as its welterweight champion. The body had declared the fighting senator as a champion in recess due to his inactivity. The Pac-Man, who lost make that who last fought in 2019, has announced he is back in training with plans to return to the ring this year. Pacquiao's camp, however, has yet to finalize who will be his next opponent. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers celebrate their Super Bowl win with a parade along the Hillsborough River. Several viewing areas were set up throughout the downtown area where Bucs fans could watch the parade. The Buccaneers, led by seven-time Super Bowl champion Tom Brady, won their second Super Bowl in franchise history by beating the Kansas City Chiefs 31-9 in Super Bowl 55. In the NBA, the Toronto Raptors showed no mercy towards the struggling Washington Wizards as they came away with a 137-115 road victory. The Raptors connected on 19 three-pointers and turned this one into a laughter with a 26-9 run in the fourth quarter. Norman Powell led Toronto with 28 points. The Raptors also held league-leading scorer Bradley Beal to just 24 points. That's 9 below his average. Toronto improved to 12-13 on the season, while Washington now has a 6-16 card and looks headed for the lottery. The beat is strong with this one. The U.S. ambassador to Vietnam drops a rap song to welcome the Lunar New Year. Dan Krintenbrick, who has served as ambassador for over 3 years, starred alongside Vietnamese rapper Wowy in a music video where they roam the streets of Vietnam. The video released by the U.S. Embassy has been viewed and shared thousands of times. The Lunar New Year is the biggest celebration in Vietnamese culture.
Okay, I'll be in touch. Thank you.
That'll do it for today. Thank you for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, Dateline Philippines podcast is on Spotify and Apple Podcast. Play back this newscast too on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.